remember looking at a dog shit on the pavement, and I suddenly realized, well, there it is. This is what life is like.
Francis Bacon, Britain's best-known artist of frightful horrors. I never met Bacon, but once, at 8:30 in the morning, I saw him on the escalator at South Kensington Underground. Our top artist. Perhaps he was on his way to the studio after a night of gambling and drinking champagne. The studio is small at the top of a narrow staircase in a quiet South Kensington mews with a single bare light bulb and a skylight. There is a chaos of brushes and paint cans and books open at colour reproductions of infected mouths and paintings by Velázquez. As he glides up the moving stairs, the station begins to hum with Francis Bacon clichés. Art after Auschwitz hums first, the horrors of the 20th century, totalitarianism and the bomb. The human condition theme, we are just sides of meat. Blurred hallucination realism, erotic male flesh, drinking with criminals and aristocrats. Soho, Fitzrovia, Mayfair, Wheelers and the Colony Room. Fivers and ten bob notes, bottles and glasses and toilets and sinks and sick. Having museum glass over your paintings and gold frames and doing triptychs when one would do and charging £1 million. Fades away into Old Brompton Road, and the fabulous hum dies down, laughing and gambling and wearing makeup. I always thought of Bacon as an actor as much as an artist. In fact, he was always completely outside the official modern art story. He didn't care about abstraction, so official modern art didn't care about him. But now nobody agrees what the modern art story really is, and somehow Bacon's art, with its screams and nightmares, and the myth of Bacon's outré lifestyle, have moved absolutely centre stage. He became known as an artist at the end of the Second World War. His first one-man show, his biographers all love to recount, was so shocking it sent appalled art lovers running screaming from the gallery. After that, he became a byword for existential horror in art.
One of the things I've noticed with critics, they always talk about this violence of my work. But I don't think that my work is violent at all. You've only got to think about life. Perhaps it's sheer naturalism that's so violent.
Bacon is all shortcuts to something we kind of already know. But he is a great something, he's a great stager. He does something painting is usually too slow for, shortcuts to deep content. He goes for impact right away. There's no sense of something being built up, of being found or excavated. He just goes straight for it, the big hits, one after another. Life, death, pain, sex, brutality, bleakness, writhing, squirming, staggering on grimly, luxurious, melancholic, humorous grimness.
Bacon loves shocks because shocks are part of life, he says, so he puts them centre stage. But once they're up there, they start declaiming and shouting and larging it like Laurence Olivier. And yet no one mentions that they are theatricalised and rhetorical. They are heavy breathing.
Ah.
spooky world of Gilbert and George. This Morecambe and Wise of existentialism, alienated middle-aged visionary gay guys imitating repressed 1930s bank managers who call themselves living sculptures and who've made their nutty image permanently identifiable with the sights and atmosphere of London's East End, began there at 30 years ago when I was 12. How far they seem from the world of then. The 60s, the counterculture, drugs, anti-war demonstrations, psychedelia. But there were two young baby artists of the period who didn't do any of that. In art schools of the 60s, it was reckoned any material could be art. So Gilbert and George chose annoyance as their main material.
This is a lot of bloody bollocks.
They had real lives before, but from now on, they would always be artificial because it was more real. Their whole lives would be art, even when they were drunk, which was every day on gin.
He's just a silly old queen.
Everything they did, they called a sculpture. Sculpture included singing or falling over, but also taking photographs and writing and making up slogans like "Art, we only wish to serve you." Serving art meant not believing anything anyone else said or thought, especially if it was a polite or normal thought. They were the unnormal.
That we are interested to de-shock the viewer. And we don't believe there's a lot that is shocking in art compared with the daily television news. We find that deeply shocking every day.
But we always want confrontation. And we want to shock them in some way because we want them to remember our pictures. We want them to be disturbed for a second. And we do believe they are shocked. They shouldn't be shocked, but they are.
Gilbert and George's own plain bodies are more and more to be seen in their art, together with the disgusting stuff that comes out of all our bodies. In their latest works, they bring all this together with something else fundamental, religious belief.
Verse 27, "But Rabshakeh said unto them, Hath my master sent me to thy master and to thee to speak these words? Hath he not sent me to the men which sit on the wall, that they may eat their own dung and drink their own piss with you?" Gilbert and George, the Bible. They were bound to clash sooner or later.
We want to be against it. We want to be... We want to ridicule the book. We ridicule with the nonsense in front of everybody for 2,000 years. They tell us, oh, you should do this, you should do that. And when you start to reading it down, you see the nonsense. And that's what we want to show to the world. Confronting with our nudity, our nakedness, that should be totally acceptable. But the Bible says no, so we say yes.